Hey folks. So I'm going to do something I haven't done in a really long time, and that's a product review. I kind of got out of the habit of doing, well, habit's not really the right word, but I kind of got out of the my habit, I guess, of doing product reviews quite a while ago. Not because I think they're bad or anything like that. I think they're actually quite useful. But I just personally, I didn't like doing them. It tends to set a trend where when you start doing them all the time, you have to keep buying more material, more products, and stuff like that to keep things flowing and keep the interest going, because people start expecting seeing them from you all the time, and that gets very expensive. And the only way to offset that is to start looking for sponsorship from the people that make these kits and products and stuff. And that puts, well, for me anyway, puts me in an uncomfortable position where, someone gives me something for free, and I feel almost obligated to say nice things about it. That's not really true. I don't. I never feel an obligation to say nice things about anybody because I'm an asshole. But still, my mother raised me to be a nice person for the most part, and I try to be for the most part. Not always. So I didn't like the position it was putting me in, so I stopped doing it a while ago. But every now and again, something kind of awesome crosses my bench, and I kind of feel inspired to maybe make mention of it. This here is one of those occasions. Brad at Tankcraft, I was talking to him, it was about, I guess, a week and a half or so, maybe 2 weeks ago. I was talking to him. I asked him about Canadian distributorship for his mats, because I was really interested in getting the tiger one, right? This one here, because I gotta say, that's some pretty snazzy shit right there. I was really wanting to get my hands on one of those things, so I was wondering, what he had on the lines or in the pipeline for Canadian distribution and stuff like that, because they're only really available in the US, and I think he has distribution set up in the UK now. Shipping from the US is very expensive for getting it up into Canada. Even though, like, the United States is only 800 or so kilometers from me, it costs a fortune to get anything shipped up here. It's actually cheaper for me to get things from the UK than it is to get things from the United States, and there's an entire ocean between us. This is really weird. I don't know why it costs so much, but it does. So, because of the really high shipping prices, I was curious to see if, he was exploring distribution in Canada. And he is. He's attempting to set things up. So during the conversation, he asked, if I minded if he sent me one, so I could take a look at it, and maybe we, talk about it on my channel. And I said, okay, we'll do that. But just so you know, the shipping's going to be really expensive and stuff, and I don't feel comfortable doing that, and but he said, no, it's okay, I'll take care of it, and he did. And I got to say, when it comes to service, customer service, Brad did everything right. This thing got here fast, it was well packaged, it was professionally done. Top marks to Brad in that department, so that was good stuff. The packaging it came in, these things came in a big cardboard, it was a, well, package box kind of thing, and there was a big label on it that says "Do not bend" and all that stuff on it. And then when you open it, these mats were inside, and each one was wrapped in cellophane and had these really professional-looking stickers on them, or labels on them. I think they're get stopped to getting the light shining on the damn thing. I can hold it properly. There we go. So, I mean, these are pretty slick, right? I mean, there's everything on here but the beans and wieners. So, I mean, that's pretty. It's pretty inclusive. I don't know what the warning is for. Is that keep mat? I can't read it. It's too far away. Keep mat flat and away from direct sunlight. Avoid extreme hot and cold temperatures. Do not make repeated cuts in the same spot. Well, that's on every one of these mats that I've ever used. So that's if you've ever used a cutting mat, you already know that. If you don't, well, you do now. So yeah. So anyway. So when I was talking to him, I was just interested in the tiger one, and that's what I expected him to send when he sent it. Actually, he sent it. I told him, I said, if you are considering sending it, you know, this is my address and stuff like that. If you're sending up Canadian distribution and all that stuff, I'd be interested in that. And then all of a sudden, I got a notice saying that he'd already shipped it. So he just didn't even bother waiting. He just, there you can have it. So he's quite the eager. So I was impressed by that as well. So anyway, what was I going to say? Oh, yeah. So anyway, so they got here really, really fast, within a week, I think it was. And it was tracked and all that stuff and everything, so that's all good. And then when they got here, I opened the box, and I was just expecting to see this. But then all of a sudden, you know, these were in there, these two extremely cool stickers. I like them both. This one's my favorite, though, because it looks like B-17 nose art. It's the one I like the best. It's pretty cool. It's pretty slick shit, that. So those were in there, and I thought that was pretty neat. But then there's another mat, and it's a Sherman mat. Now, the Sherman mat, you know, it looks to me almost like it's 35th scale, but it's, I think, maybe just slightly bigger than 35th scale. Maybe it might be 32nd. It's probably 32nd scale. I mean, I took a 35th scale Sherman, the wet hull, and stuck it on there, the welded hull, and stuck it on there, and this is just a smidge bigger, so I think it's probably, this is 32nd scale. So, but either way, and this is like maybe 1/24th scale. I have a 1/24th or 1/25th scale on the shelf behind me, so it's closer to that. So, I don't know if he's actually written the scale on here. No, I don't see it anyway. Nope. I imagine that'd be because he has these all come in different sizes, so the scale would change. I imagine the printing would get annoying to do if you had to put the scale legend on there. That'd be annoying. So that makes sense. But anyway, they're pretty damn cool. So Brad asked me if I would do, you know, kind of a walk around on these things, and I told him I would. Now, I have all kinds of these cutting mats. I've had dozens of them over the years and stuff like that. And, you know, they come in various degrees of quality and thicknesses and stuff like that. And they really only serve one purpose, and that's to be destroyed over a long period of time. And you want that period of time to be as long as possible. You know, barring horrible incidents like exposing it to sunlight, fire, extreme temperatures, and more information. What it says here at the bottom. I'm reading that. So, you know, barring those things, it should actually last a very long time. Now, this big green cutting mat that I've had here, I've had this for like 10 years. And the one that's on my build bench, I've had that for maybe half as long. And then I have another one just over here and another one over there. And both of those I've had since I got back into the hobby 20 years ago. So, you know, they can last a really, really long time. Now, the ones that are over there and over there, they look like they're 20 years old. They're black and covered in every friggin' piece of shit you can possibly imagine. This one here is, I use this one on this is the diorama bench. This is where I build dioramas. It gets covered in glue and paint and all kinds of stuff and everything. So it's actually still pretty good condition, but the grid lines that were on it, they're on the other side, they're completely destroyed. So I'm using the back side now. It's the same thing with my other mat on the other bench. I have it flipped over because the grid lines are all gone. Now, I am not going to attempt to destroy either of these. I could take some, to me, extra thin and just pour it on here and see what happens. I could tell you what's going to happen. All these nice little pretty lines would just be gone. And then there's going to be a bleach mark where I poured the to me extra thin. So, because I already know that's what's going to happen, I'm not going to, because I'm going to save these things for doing presentations. So, if you're thinking I'm going to do that, you think again, because I'm not going to. But I've told you what would happen if I did. It would destroy it. These things, no cutting mat that I am aware of can withstand the effects of to me extra thin or lacquer thinner. It will fuck it. There's just, the materials are not compatible. To my knowledge, no one makes a cutting mat that's resistant to either of those caustic materials. That being said, they should be resistant to cutting materials, cutting tools, and stuff like that. They are cutting mats, so they're supposed to be resistant to that. I happen to have a cutting tool, a standard cutting tool, one that we use for everything. It's a nice X-Acto Gripster. I've had this one here particularly for 3 or 4 years. So, you know, it's tried and tested. And I'm going to attempt to cut the mat using a straight edge, which is the most aggressive way to do it. So, but I'm going to do it in a space that's not so visible because, again, I want to use these for presentations at one point. So we'll just go like that. Yep. And it does what a cutting mat does and just turns into a little scratch. It does exactly what I expected it to do. Now it really came onto that and yeah, it didn't even penetrate it. So that is very typical of a good quality cutting mat. I only have two really good quality cutting mats in my cave. And now I have two more by the looks of it. Yeah, it just leaves a scratch. And that's what I expected it to do. So it, as cutting mats go, they're very typical and resilient when it comes to these tools. Now, if you're going to be using serrated knives on your cutting mat, they're not going to put up with that. I can tell you that right now, that's not what they're designed for, so they will not survive it. So I guess you'd probably void the manufacturer's warranty if you did that. So now these are thicker than the standard cutting mats that I have around here. This big green one here is a Fiskars one that I got at Michael's Arts and Crafts. It's a franchise in North America that sells craft stuff and everything. And this cost me a great deal of money, this great big one here. It's the A2, I think is the size. It's the second biggest one you can get. It cost me like $75-$80 Canadian, so it's pretty pricey. But it is about half as thick as this. And this has lasted me for 10 years. And I expect this to last just as long because the other two cutting mats, the smaller ones that I have, one on either side that I've had for 20, are this thick. And both of these cutting mats are the same thickness. They are both, looks like 4 millimeters. Let's see, I don't know what it says on here. No, it doesn't say, oh, 3 millimeters. 3 millimeters thick. 3 millimeters thick. So, and I know this one over here and that one over there are both 3 millimeters because I can see they're both the same thickness. Actually, no, the one over there is, that's two. This one's three. This one here is a 3-1. Yeah, yeah. So I expect this to last just as long as that one there. In fact, it's the same. This is the same size as the one that's over there. So, now, when it comes to cutting mats, I mean, they're really only supposed to serve one purpose, and that's for cutting and stuff like that. And I just proved that, that they hold up to that quite well. Yeah. I'm just opening it to see how much it gaps, and there's hardly any opening at all. But that's typical for every cutting mat I've ever used. When it comes to cutting mats, when you're cutting on them, you don't want to sit there doing this over the same spot over and over and over and over again, because when you do that, you're eventually going to find your way through. So when you're using your cutting mat, you know, you make cuts over here and you make cuts over here, and, you know, you rotate your cutting mats, you know, so you don't wear them out. That's kind of what you do if you're going to be doing a lot of cutting. Now, as modelers, depends on what you do. You only do certain amounts of cutting, and you tend to do it very focused, so you tend to wear out one spot on your mat more than others, if you're like me anyway, where the way you work. So, you know, you end up having to rotate your cutting mat and stuff like that. You'll have to do that a lot less with a mat this thick, because these are the uber thick ones. You can get thicker ones than this, but they're very crazy expensive. So now, color wise, well, I don't know. I guess it's a preference thing, right? I don't really have a preference. I'm used to the green ones. And everybody I know really uses them, except for one guy who uses a bright yellow one. Hi, Gav. I don't even know where he got that. It's pretty crazy. It's like crazy bright yellow. But these are, I'm going to go ahead and call them modeling colors. They're very typical for it. Like this is Panzer, like a Panzer gray. And this is like an olive drab green, almost like a British. Actually, no, it's a little bit limey for British. It's more, it's more like U.S. olive drab. One of the many olive drabs. So yeah. So color-wise, yeah, they're pretty appealing. Now, and then there's the artwork. All right. I mean, that's pretty freaking cool. I mean, if you look at that, that's some slick shit. All right. I mean, you've got the graduated lines for inches, and you got centimeters on the outside. I think myself, I would have preferred to have the centimeters graduated as much as the inches are graduated. As you can see, the inches have numbers on them. I would have liked to have the centimeters also the same way, because I'm not an American. I use centimeters for almost all of my work. But I'm also Canadian, which means half of my culture still uses centimeters and inches. So I can flip-flop back and forth. I guess it's bilingual when it comes to measuring, if you want to call it anything. But you know, in Europe and stuff like that, and actually everywhere else in the world, it's just really America and Canada kind of uses the inches and stuff these days. And Canada really doesn't anymore either. But either way, the rest of, I guess, the world would probably want to see the centimeter lines graduated as well with numbers. Just, I don't know, for ease sake. Yeah, I guess that's it for that. There's some interesting cheat sheet information on the Sherman tank, and there's also the same cheat sheet information on the Tiger. I haven't actually looked to see if it's correct. I'm just looking now. Well, it's sort of correct. Sort of. There, it's actually, it depends on which Tiger tank variant you're talking about. So this is, looks like the early one. Might even be the initial. Looks like a bit of both, actually. This, I know less about the Sherman, so I don't know. Just looking at it now. Yeah, it's the same. Maybe for this, I don't know that much about that one, so I don't know. Shermans are not something I know an enormous amount. I know quite a bit about the Tiger, but the Sherman is a little bit, because there's so many different ones, it's a bit more vague. So, but either way, it's interesting to have that. It's just mostly for bragging rights, but it's still pretty freaking cool. So, one of the things that I liked about this is it has the center marks, right, for layout, which is pretty handy. It's very easy to find the center when you have these, right? Just for a quick second, you can easily find the center. It's on both of them too. You can quickly find your center of your mat. So you can use your mat as a center of reference, right? If you want to put it in the center of your shot very easily, and there's the middle there. And I'm looking at the camera at an odd angle, so you know it's fairly easy for me to find the center there and then just look up at the camera to see if it's in the middle of the screen. So it's good for doing presentations and stuff like that. But it's also good for, you know, if you need to quickly find right angles and stuff like that, because these things are all lined up properly. But if you need to find the center of something, and you know, this is just laid out in a very convenient fashion. So what else? What else can you actually say about a cutting mat? I don't really know. Other than they're pretty fucking cool bling on your bench, and yeah, it's just I love the white, because it's like blueprints, right? And it's what caught my attention when I first looked at it, is this the white for the drawings. It's really slick shit. So yeah, other than they're just cool, right? What else do you want? They're just fucking cool. So yeah, so I gotta say to Brad, you know, thanks for these, because holy shit, they're awesome. I really like them. and they're making me happy. So these are probably going to show up in a lot of different videos because they're going to be my presentation mats now, I think. Now you'll see me do, when I do talk arounds and stuff like that, you'll see me with just some shit on my bench and I'm spinning it and talking about it. But now it'll be sitting on one of these, so, because they're cool. And that's about it. So, but anyway, I don't know if that was useful, but I sure as hell like these things. So anyway, there's a link to Tankcraft in the video description if you want to go and have a chat with Brad and see what he can do for you. Yeah, that's about it. That's all I got. You guys be good. Keep your stick on the ice. Bye for now.